almost feel like the music today is preached, and maybe I don't need to. You just thought I wasn't going to preach. Well, if you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Genesis. But wow, the music has been great this morning, hasn't it? What depth and what truth. I'm thankful that we can sing songs that have gospel grit, gospel depth, and can really impact our lives. Thank you, Amanda, for that song. That was a powerful blessing to my heart. Just thinking about Jesus and what he has for waiting for us and what he's done for us. Are we good to go, guys? Thank you. Well, this morning we're looking at the life of Abraham here in Genesis 12 through 22. So I would encourage you over the next couple of weeks to read those chapters. This is really just going to be a survey over the quick survey over the life of Abraham and talking about his life. And I've just gleaned a few thoughts from his life that we're going to talk about today in light of our series entitled In the Beginning, Grace. And really one of the main thoughts in our series as we've studied the book of Genesis has been to come away with the right foundation for the entire Bible. So many times people view this book in the wrong way. Either they view this book as simply a history book or a science book or a morality book. But it's none of those things. Oh, it talks about all those things. It talks about history. It talks about science. It talks about morality. But the foundational reality of what this book is all about is this book is a revelation of the God of the universe. It's revealing to us the great heart that God has for us. And so if you would, as we get started here this morning studying the life of Abraham, if you've ever played, how many of you, when you were growing up, you played neighborhood sports of some kind? Maybe it was soccer, basketball, football, baseball. Raise your hand if you played any neighborhood sports. You know, all the kids got together at the playground and they, you know, played sports. Now, what was the way that people would choose teams? What was the way that the kids would choose teams? You would pick two team captains, and then what would those team captains do? Those team captains would start to pick from the lineup, correct? They would start picking from the lineup of kids. And if you were a smart team captain, who would you pick to be on your team? The athletic people, the fast people, the strong people. And who was it that got picked last? Don't point to anybody in here. That wasn't the purpose of the illustration. I have to admit, there were a couple of times where I felt really bad. I actually got picked last a couple of times. But yeah, I was not the most athletically equipped, shall we say. Who would like to just be honest, and maybe we can give some sympathy to you? How many of you were picked last on some of the neighborhood game teams? Good. I'm glad it wasn't just me. Well, the point is that from a very early age, we realized that our world was built around conditionality. It was built around performance. And so the good players, the ones who could perform well, got picked first. And the ones who got chosen last were the uncoordinated, the non-athletic, or shall we say, the rejects. Well, here's a question. Who would survive God's lineup? If God was picking teams, the assumption would be, based on our experience, is that God would pick the most spiritually well-behaved, the most spiritually coordinated, the ones who are usable. That's who God picks. Certainly God wouldn't pick the unpickable. Certainly God wouldn't choose those who can't bring anything to the table. But what we find as we study the Word of God over and over and over is that the grace of God doesn't work the way that we would think it works at all. The grace of God is scandalous. It flips the paradigm. It challenges our assumptions. It shatters our expectations. In this story about Abraham today, we are dazzled once again with the reality that God has chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the mighty. He's chosen the weak things of this world to confound the things that are strong. And you know what that means? That's good news for you and me. Because if we're all honest in here, we would all say, I have felt many times in my life where I didn't deserve to be picked. I don't know why you would even pick me, God. Look at what I've done. Look at who I've hurt. Look at what I've become. I'm not happy about what I've become. And perhaps you're in here this morning and you're struggling and you've come into church today and you're like, man, I think church is for perfect people because I know I failed this week and God can't ever use me. I've done something in my life that I just can't ever recover from. Well, relax. You're going to hear some good news today. You're going to hear about a God who will still choose you. Oh, yes, there might be consequences from what we've done. We're going to study a life today. He dealt with consequences the rest of his life because of some of his actions. But it did not stop God from showering Abraham's life with grace. And it was grace that came without footnotes, without pre-existing qualifications. God does not, here's the good news of the gospel. God doesn't choose us because of who we are or what we can offer. He chooses us simply because of who He is. I like how our guest speaker yesterday at our luncheon said it. She said, the story of Abraham is not a story about Abraham, really. It's a story about God. Every story in the Bible is a story about, ultimately, about God. He's the main character of the entire Bible. And we see a different facet of His grace, His mercy, His goodness, all these qualities wrapped up in one. We see that in every story of the Bible. And so let me ask you this question. I think you already know the answer. But a lot of times I hear the Old Testament characters referred to as what? Old Testament saints. And that's not necessarily a bad phrase, but sometimes, if we're not careful, that slips into this thinking that Genesis is a book full of heroes that did great things for God. So let me ask you, was Genesis a story about Abraham, the faithful saint? Was Abraham's story a story about a faithful saint or a trophy of grace? I think you're going to see today that this is a story about a trophy of grace. You see, God's grace really shows us that God has a stubborn delight in stubborn people. Abraham was an immoral idolater who was scandalously chosen by God and given exceeding great promises that for many religious people, just rubs them wrong. It rubs against their assumptions and their misconceptions that have creeped into their thinking about why God would choose Abraham. And so I want to just give you three quick thoughts that are really broad survey type thoughts about the life of Abraham. And I hope that these will encourage you, and I think that we're going to be able to draw some great lessons from it today. Number one, we see Abraham's underwhelming resume. As I just mentioned to you, Genesis is not a book of heroes who did great things for God. Really, Genesis is a book about the hero, God, who can work through imperfect people, people who don't have a lot to offer. But unfortunately, many times how we read the book of Genesis is that we say, okay, God used this person because they were usable. God used this person because they were good. God used this person because they earned the right to be used. But what Genesis really reveals to us, if we'll read it closely, is it's a collection of sinners in need of a God who saves to the uttermost. That's what we've studied so far. We've learned that about the story of Adam and Eve. We've learned that in the story about Cain and Abel. We've learned that in the story about Noah. And guys, I'm having, again, some issues with this screen up here. It keeps cutting in and out on me, Brian, so I don't know what's going on there. But anyway, we'll... You always got to like technical difficulties. You might say, what's going on, Pastor? I've got a screen up here that helps me know where these screens are at so I don't get lost in my notes. But anyway, that's fine. So number one, Abraham's underwhelming resume. During the time of Jesus, there were some thoughts going around about Abraham as to why God would use him. Some people struggled with thinking, how could God use Abraham? And so a lot of stories were created, kind of backstories to the life of Abraham. And backstories to the life of Abraham were created. And Brian, I'm just going to have you follow. And so as you read this, I'm not going to worry about clicking because this is distracting me. That's okay. You just go ahead and click, buddy. Aren't you thankful for our sound team? They do a great job. And demons sometimes get into our technology and try to distract the preacher. So anyway, but Abraham's underwhelming resume. How many of you have ever, and I'll get back to what I was saying in just a second, how many of you have ever applied for a job? You applied for a job? What'd you do? You put together a resume, right? Let me ask you a question. On the resume, did you put your failures on the resume or your successes on the resume? Well, of course you put your successes. It'd be kind of weird if you put your failures on there. Now, that might come across good to a hiring boss who's going to hire you. Maybe that was a good thing. But no, the facts are we don't put our failures on there. We put our successes. But the carnal mind of man struggles with understanding why God would use Abraham. And so they come up with these reasons why God could have used him. They think that Abraham had a worthy resume, that Abraham had a list of good qualities, that Abraham was an honest guy, that Abraham was, God foresaw that Abraham was going to be a good boy, and so that's why God chose him. And so there were stories going around at the time of Christ, kind of these created backstories about the life of Abraham, about why God would choose him. Listen to some of these ideas that were floating around in some of the rabbinical literature of Jesus' day. Number one, some had thought that Abraham was an astronomer who discovered that there was only one God. Through maybe Abraham's process of going outside and looking at the stars at night, he looked up and somehow he discovered that there was only one true God, and maybe that's why God chose him. And so this was a story that was created because they're like, why would God just all of a sudden look at this idolater in Ur and choose him out of all the people in the world? Why would God do that? And so these backstories were created to say, oh, well, maybe it was because Abraham was an astronomer and somehow through his looking up at the stars, he discovered that there was only one God, and that's why God chose him. A second thought floating around during the time of Christ about Abraham was that Abraham was supposedly well known in his day for protesting the idolatry of his peers. And so that's another thought. People say, well, God chose Abraham because Abraham was protesting against the idolatry of his day. But you don't find that in the beginnings of Abraham's story in Genesis chapter number 12. You don't see that. Another reason that people created was they said Abraham would not help build the Tower of Babel in Genesis 10 and 11. He would not help build the Tower of Babel, and this is what supposedly made him worthy of God's call. He was supposedly imprisoned by the builders of the Tower of Babel, but was spared by God when the tower was destroyed. And so these three thoughts were created in a way because it couldn't compute to the religious mind of Jesus' day why God would choose Abraham. So, oh, God must have chose Abraham because he was either an astronomer that somehow discovered the one true God, he was speaking out against the idolatry of his day, or he refused to help in building the Tower of Babel. That's why God chose him. But none of those reasons you find in the Bible. In fact, you find Abraham, yes, did Abraham do some good things in his life at a few instances? Certainly. It says in Genesis 15, verse 6, that he believed God. He had faith in God. It says in Genesis 17 that he believed that God was going to give him a son. In Genesis 22, it talks about how Abraham proved his faith by being willing to offer up his son Isaac. And so in those few instances, we see the story of a man who would exercise faith. But as you really get to story in the life of Abraham, you find out there were a lot of things that Abraham miserably failed at. Immediately after God gave the promise to Abraham in Genesis 12, we find that he flees to Egypt for some reason. He flees to Egypt and nearly loses his life by lying to another man, telling him that she is his sister. So Abraham flees to Egypt. Abraham's afraid that he's going to get killed and his wife's going to get taken, so he allows Pharaoh to take his wife. Ladies, how many of you would consider it a brave thing if in the middle of a dark alley, your husband was willing to hand you over to some criminals who had bad intentions towards you? How many of you would think, oh, that's a brave husband? But that's exactly what Abraham did. Abraham fled to Egypt. he says, hey, these guys might kill me if they find out that you're my wife, so tell them that I'm your sister, that you're my sister, so that they won't kill me. Wow, great job, Abraham. Way to have faith in the promise of God. If you keep reading, read in Genesis 16 and 17, obviously there God gives Abraham the promise that he's going to give to him a son. But Abraham and Sarah start thinking, oh, we're going to help God out. Yeah, God promised to give us a son, but obviously God can't do it through us. So, hey, Sarah came up with this great idea. Hey, Abraham, I'm going to give to you my handmaiden, Hagar. And you're going to have a physical relationship with her. And you're going to have a child through Hagar. How many of you ladies would be up for polygamy? No. Abraham was a doubting idolater and a polygamist, and he had a physical relationship with somebody who wasn't his wife because he thought he was trying to help God out. Wow, Abraham's a poster boy for good behavior. Oh, and in case you're wondering, in case you didn't learn the lesson the first time about the Pharaoh in Egypt, later on in Genesis 20, Abraham lies again about his wife Sarah. Again, he's afraid that the Philistines and the king Abimelech are going to kill him because Sarah is so beautiful. And he's like, hey, tell them that you're my sister so that they don't kill me. Wow, great, Abraham. Way to be brave. Way to trust the promises of God. And again, God has to miraculously step in, both in the situation with Pharaoh and with Abimelech. And he has to stop these men from making Sarah their wife, if you get the point. No wonder Paul, when he was reaching for an Old Testament example of grace, no wonder that he reaches back and goes straight to Abraham. Folks, when you really study the story of Abraham, God didn't choose Abraham because he was a good boy. God didn't choose Abraham because he was choosable, because he was usable. God chose Abraham for mysteries that we might not ever fully know, but God chose Abraham because of God, not because of Abraham. Abraham had an underwhelming resume. Abraham wasn't seeking after God at the time of his call. I love how C.S. Lewis puts it. He says, modern man loves to talk about man's search for God. By experience, I can tell you that that's about as foolish as talking about the mouse's search for the cat. Y'all remember the cartoons, Tom and Jerry? Yeah, right? Jerry's not going to go purposely seeking after Tom. And what C.S. Lewis is saying is, listen, if you think that modern man is searching for God, by experience, I can tell you that that's about as foolish as saying that a mouse is searching for a cat. Abraham wasn't searching after God. Abraham did not have a qualifying resume. He didn't have a resume that would get him picked by God. But yet we think this. We think, oh, look at my resume, God. Aren't you impressed with my resume of behaviors? You know, there was another guy in the Bible that was impressed with his resume. In Luke chapter 18, verses 11 and 12, there's a Pharisee and he's praying with himself. And he says, God, I thank thee that I am not as other men are. You know what that Pharisee's doing? He's saying, God, look at my resume. I'm not an extortioner. I'm not unjust. I'm not an adulterer, or even as this publican over here that's praying. I fast twice in the week. I give tithes of all that I possess. What was this Pharisee doing? He was taking glory in his resume. How about you this morning? Why? Boy, this gets down to where the rubber meets the road. Why did you come to church this morning? Was it to add to your resume so that this week when you get into a tough situation, you're going to go, hey, God, you remember this last Sunday, God? Yeah, I'm about to face a tough situation. Hey, God, you owe me. I went to church this last Sunday. I even put 10 bucks or 20 bucks or whatever in the offering plate. God, you're going to protect my family, right? You know what? That's what the pagan idol worshipers did. That's how they treat. That's not how the God of the Bible operates. The God of the Bible is only impressed with one resume, and it's not yours or mine. It's the resume of Jesus Christ in his perfect, righteous history and life. And when God looks at you, he doesn't see your resume if you've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. You know whose resume he sees? He sees Jesus Christ's resume. And I'm so thankful that when I stand before God, I don't have to give to Him my stack of resumes that I think are going to earn me entrance into heaven. I'm thankful that when I stand before God, there's one resume that God's going to look at, and it is the righteous, perfect history of Jesus Christ. But we see in the story of Abraham, Abraham did not have an impressive resume. If there is anything that most modern preaching misses about the story of Abraham, it's that Abraham was a crook. He was a scoundrel. He was a liar. He was a doubter. He was an adulterer. Abraham did not deserve to be called by God, and neither do you and I. It's because of his matchless, marvelous, overwhelming grace. You see, we have an underwhelming resume, but God has overwhelming grace, which brings us to our second point, and that is this. We see not only Abraham's underwhelming resume, but number two, we see God's unconditional resolve. God's unconditional resolve. The call of God on Abraham's life was not a reward for anything that Abraham was or a reward for anything that Abraham did. It was an unconditional call of grace. It was all of grace. And we see the resolve of God throughout this story. Oh, I challenge you. We don't have time to go through it all. But read starting from Genesis 12 and keep on reading and see, even in the midst of Abraham's failures, God's unrelenting resolve to Abraham. You see, this story in Genesis 12 through 22 is not a story about Abraham's faithfulness. It's a story about God's faithfulness. It's about this. It's the story about a God who will never leave you nor forsake you. It's the story about a God who was so resolved in rescuing humanity that He would be a greater picture than even Abraham and Isaac in Genesis 22. He would send His own son to be the sacrifice. So you see, grace is not given so that we are highlighted and showcased. Grace is given to us so that God, the giver, is highlighted and showcased. Why did we sing all about Jesus today? Because it's really all about Him. It's about Him. It's about God's unconditional resolve. It's about God's relentless pursuit of sinners in need of a Savior. Now, how does this reach into our world? How does this rub against the way that we're brought up? We'll go back to the lineup illustration that we started the service with. Our world is built upon conditionality. God's world is not built that way. And on His relationship to us, it is not built that way. You see, we love if-then propositions. Now just think about that statement. We love if-then propositions. If I do this, you will do this. We do this all the time with our kids, don't we? If you eat your vegetables, then you'll get dessert. We do this in marriage. By the way, do you realize that your marriage is not meant to be an if-then proposition? It's actually meant to be a, put this in my notes, it's actually meant to be a because-therefore proposition, pronouncement. But we love if-then propositions. We're addicted to them. Almost every single one of our relationships at some level is governed by if-then conditionality. We do this all the time. As I mentioned, if you eat your vegetables, then you'll get your dessert. But in God's economy, He flips the paradigm and He says, I'm going to give you dessert before you eat your vegetables. Now, kids, don't go out and try that. Say, Mom and Dad, you need to be like God. Give me my dessert before you... No. Now, maybe they'll want to do that. I don't know. But the point is that God flips the expectation. But the problem is this kind of conditionality that says God gives us the dessert before we eat our vegetables, that makes us feel unsafe. The conditionality is safe. It's predictable. It's formulaic. If I do this, then I'll get this. And so we get a hold of our ledgers and our scorecards, and this creates a sense of entitlement. Because if we do enough ifs, then we're like, man, I'm entitled to the thens. And this, oh boy, you see this all the time in marriages. I have done this, 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 and this, and you still don't. What's that person saying? Look at all the ifs I've done. Now then, you need to do this for me. You see, we live in a world of conditionality. And granted, to a certain extent, we have to live in a world that way, don't we? I mean, in a job situation, you aren't going to get the then if you don't do the if. If you don't come into work, you're not going to then get paid. And so to a certain extent, it's just how our world works today. But even in that, we can see this battle going on. If I can do this or that, then I will be able to obligate others to give to me what it is that I'm looking for and longing for. We live in a world where we can't even imagine it being anything different. In his book, Justification by Faith, and commentary on this study in the life of Abraham, a man by the name of Gerhard Ford said this. He said, "The gospel of justification by faith is such a shocker, it's such an explosion, because it is an absolutely unconditional promise. It is not an if-then kind of statement, but a because-therefore pronouncement. Because Jesus died and rose again, your sins are forgiven, and you are righteous in the sight of God. How can it be entirely unconditional, our mind thinks? Isn't that terribly dangerous? How can anyone say flat out, you're righteous because of Jesus? Is there not some price that must be paid on our part? Something, however small, to be done? After all, there can't be such a thing as a free lunch, can there be?" So the human mind struggles with this. You see, we really are sealed up in the prison of our conditional thinking, the writer goes on to say. It is terribly difficult for us to get out. And even if someone bats down the door and shatters the bars, chances are we'll stay in prison anyway. We seem always to want to hold out for something, somehow, that little bit of something. And we do it with a passion and an anxiety that betrays its true source, the old Adam that just does not want to lose control. Unconditional love is absolutely foreign and unreal to us in our world today. The only kind of love that we can probably liken unconditional love to is the love that we have for our kids, right? I mean, our kids can do a lot of terrible things, but it doesn't change the fact that we love them unconditionally. And so in a sense, we get a glimpse of God's unconditional love and the love that we have for our children. And no wonder God calls us children of God, His children. But what we must understand is when lavish love is given, when you're at your worst, it actually compels you to want to change. And this is the hard part, because people are like, "Pastor, you can't tell people that God loves you no matter what. Because if you tell people that God loves them no matter what, then they're just going to go out and do whatever they want." And that's the common thinking. But when you truly believe that God loves you no matter what, I'm telling you, it changes what you want to do. You change. You find, oh, there's a different set of wants there. I'm no longer afraid of my wants. I'm no longer feeding the lies of the devil that say, my old wants are greater than my new wants. God's given me a new heart through the new covenant, through the new birth, through the finished work of Jesus. He unconditionally loves me. Oh yeah, I could sin a million more times and it wouldn't change His love for me. Of course, I would have a lot of scars and a lot of baggage and a lot of consequences from that. But it changes His love for me not one nanometer. That's how much He loves us, His unconditional resolve. God proves throughout the story of the life of Abraham that grace is love that seeks us out when we have nothing to give. Abraham did not have anything to offer God. It was a gift. Grace was a gift bestowed upon Abraham. It wasn't a wage that Abraham earned. Grace is not able to be earned. If it's able to be earned, it's not grace. It's not a gift. It's your wage. What was the proof of this unconditional resolve that God gave to Abraham? One of the most fascinating stories in all the Bible is Genesis 15. One of the most theologically packed, doctrinally deep and rich passages in all the Bible is Genesis 15, because God is going to prove His love and grace to Abraham through a covenant ceremony. And doesn't that make sense? Even in our culture today, we seal important decisions in covenant ceremonies, right? Marriage, that's a covenant ceremony, a wedding, a covenant ceremony of marriage. And so we seal important decisions like that. In business and finance, we seal important decisions by doing what? By sitting down at a table at a lawyer's office and signing papers. Covenant ceremony. Putting your name on the dotted line. So God had given these promises to Abraham, and Abraham, I think, was struggling a little bit with doubt. And he's like, God, how do I know that you're going to do all this? And God says, I'm going to prove it, Abraham. Abraham, I want you to take these animals, and I want you to cut these animals in half, and I want you to put one on one side, one on the other, make an aisle down the center. And typically back in those days, how a covenant ceremony would work is that the lesser person in the two-person agreement would actually be the one to walk through the pieces, because the lesser didn't have as much to lose as the greater. And in this story, the greater obviously would have been God. And so really, in this covenant ceremony, Abraham should have been walking through the pieces. Now, you might say, man, that's a lot of blood and guts. Why would God have Abraham cut these pieces of animal? Because literally, what people were saying when they walked through these pieces in this ceremony is they were saying, listen, I promise to do this, and if I break my word, may I be cut and dashed into pieces just like these animals are right here in front of us. That's how serious that promise, that ceremony was. It was one of the most important ceremonies you can make. But as I said, typically in those agreements, the lesser would be the one walking through the pieces. Why? Because the lesser didn't have as much to lose in the agreement as the greater. But in this story, the greater is the only one to walk through the pieces. In fact, the lesser wasn't even awake during the ceremony. He was asleep, and he never walked through the pieces. You know what that's teaching us? That God made an unconditional promise to Abraham. Abraham, I love you. I will never forsake you. Abraham, I'm proving this with my very life. Even if I have to give up my own life, I'm proving my love for you. And ultimately, God did that for the entire world when he sent his son. When he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die for us, proving his love. God so loved the world. How did he prove it? By sending his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So it wasn't Abraham and God that passed through the pieces. No, it was only God that walked through those pieces of those animals. The promise does not depend on Abraham's life, nor is it conditioned on Abraham's death. It is God who walked through the pieces. That was shocking to the Jewish mind of that day. They would have been, whoa, 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 reverse. That doesn't make sense. Abraham should have been walking through the pieces. And they can't understand this. But this was indicating that if this covenant fails, God himself would die, but we know that this covenant would not fail because he would seal it through his own death. Here's the point I'm trying to make. In Christianity alone, the God who makes the demands also met the demands. There is no other. Listen, you might be here this morning. You might say, I am done with religion. I am done with all these religions in the world. They all talk about God. There's nothing different in any of them. Wrong. This is the only faith that says God not only made the demands, but he met the demands through his son, Jesus Christ. He met them. He not only made them. In Christianity alone, we see this. Plain and simple. And this is so simple that most will be offended at that kind of God. But that's the God that is revealed in this book. You can like it, you can reject it, you can try to muddy it or twist it, but the truth is, God not only made the demands, but he met the demands. We see Jesus fulfilled all of God's holy conditions so that our relationship to God could be holy, unconditional, unbalanced. There's no balance in that. It's one-way love, as one writer put it. One-way love. We love him, why? Because he first loved us. This great reality of God's unconditional resolve is not just what gets us saved, but it is what continues to amaze us on a daily basis. It's not just what ignites the Christian life. This is what continues to fuel the Christian life in everyday living. So Abraham did not have an impressive resume to offer to God. We see that God had an undeniable resolve or an unrelenting resolve for Abraham. But finally, we see the undeniable essence. What can we learn from the story of Abraham? What can we learn from his life? We see that God made these great and precious promises to not only him and his family, but to make of him a great nation. And ultimately, there were spiritual promises tied to the life of Abraham. We know that we as the church are the fulfillment of the Abrahamic promise that God made to Abraham, the Abrahamic covenant, in a sense that we are now all blessed in Abraham. And so God made these promises. Abraham struggled to believe them. This is another reason why I know Christianity is true. I'm so thankful for the honesty of the Bible. It's not like the Bible whitewashes these characters and says, oh, look at Abraham. He was a good little Sunday school boy. No, Abraham failed miserably. But that only accentuated and magnified the grace of God. But I bring you back to this thought in Romans chapter 4, verse 5, where it says, Romans 4, verse 5, but to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. What are the undeniable lessons for us in this story today? Number one, we must stop seeking to balance, deaden, dull, and dilute the radical nature of God's amazing grace. But this is exactly what people try to do when they hear about the grace of God. They try to balance it. They try to weaken it a little bit. Oh, don't tell them that, Pastor. Don't tell them that. Because they'll just go out and do whatever they want, but you're missing half the gospel when you say that kind of stuff. Because you're forgetting that God changes once through the power of his resurrection and through the gift of his Spirit. And so if balance is what you're interested in, you will not be interested in true grace. Grace is free. It runs in the wide open. You cannot tame it or put conditions on it. It's not managed by you, but by God. The announcement of grace that comes from God has no buts and no breaks. But sadly, many Christians think that they are being a responsible Christian by adding buts into grace. You know, yes, grace, but dot, dot, dot. I'm convinced that that response originated with the devil in Genesis chapter 3. Yes, grace, but. You see, folks, it's grace, period. How amazed would this world be at grace if God chose the best looking? I mean, in God's lineup, if he always chose the best looking, the best behaved, the best qualified, those who showed promise of his worthy investment of a gift, if that was the case, no one would be amazed at it. Right? I mean, if God chose the best, he would have chosen the Pharisees when he was on earth. But what we actually find is God chose fishermen, not Pharisees. God chose tax collectors. God chose social outcasts like Zacchaeus. Nobody wanted to go to Zac's house, but Jesus did. That's what so scandalized the religious crowd of Jesus' day. The good people would eventually kill Jesus because they couldn't understand how Jesus could eat with the bad people. So the good people killed Jesus. If our churches are not attracting the same kind of people that Jesus attracted, then we are not preaching the same message that Jesus preached. Uh-oh. Exactly. That's right. That's the second lesson. And I really hope this sinks in for us. Anybody that walks through our doors is welcome here because Jesus died for them too. What kind of people are we attracting to this church? Just churched people? Okay. We can sit around and build our Christian Bible clubs. But if we're not interested in attracting the same people that were attracted to Jesus, then are we preaching the same message that Jesus preached? Church? You've got to answer that in your own heart. But I'm going to tell you what this pastor is resolved to do. This pastor is resolved to preach the same message that Jesus preached and attract the same people that Jesus attracts, so that those people's lives can be transformed for the glory of God. Man, that's a lesson we've got to take away. I would have never chosen Abraham. In my religious mind, I would have walked right past Abraham and said, there's no hope for him. He's a pagan idolater. He's going to be a polygamist. He's going to lie about his wife and give her over to Pharaoh and Abimelech to do with her as they please. I would have never chosen Abraham, but you know who did? God did. Aren't you thankful that Christianity wasn't invented by you and your thinking, or mine and my thinking? You see, again, people were scandalized by this with Jesus. Luke 15, verses 1 and 2 tells us about how Jesus was eating with these sinners. He was receiving them and eating with them. And the Pharisees and scribes were murmuring. So I guess the question is which group do you want to be a part of? You want to be a part of the crowd who's always criticizing Jesus and murmuring and complaining? Or do you want to be a part of the group that sees lives transformed because Jesus is receiving sinners and eating with them? You see, God justifies the ungodly. God doesn't justify the godly. There's no need to justify godly people. They're already godly. But the Bible says there's none godly, none good, no, not one. We've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. And so, again, if we resist a message like this, I'm telling you, it's your flesh resisting it, because the part of us that needs to die is the part of us that keeps resisting. It is finished. God's grace is enough. Jesus is enough. In my place, condemned he stood, sealed my pardon with his blood. Hallelujah. What a Savior. No buts. No breaks, no qualifications, no footnotes, totally unbalanced. But my friends, that's the good news, and that's your only hope, and that's my only hope. And praise God for his stubborn delight in stubborn people. Praise God for his grace that not only saves us, but sanctifies us and transforms us as we behold his beauty and his grace. Let's pray together.